be a magician, and you're going to get up and do your act, and the guy right before you told everybody how you did your tricks. Your act would flop, would it not? Because, oh, we know how you did that, right? All right, well, I'm going to talk to you this morning, teach you, whatever, is how to correct the Bible, okay? Now, having said that, you know and I know you cannot correct the Bible, right? Okay, there's no mistakes in it, so you can't correct it. But the reason I say that is because, and guys, I know you believe the book, but you have heard some guy get up behind a pulpit and say, now the Greek word here is this, and it really shouldn't have been put this way, it should have been put this way. And even though you believe your King James Bible, you are intimidated, impressed, awed, or bullied by what the guy said. You say, I can't compete with him, I can't meet him on that academic level, correct? Agree with me. Okay, see, I heard that. When you nodded, I heard that. That's very good back there. Anyway, I'm going to teach you how to correct the Bible in about a half an hour, 45 minutes, because you go and you hear this guy. This guy gets up and he tells you all this Greek stuff, and you go, you come up, I want you to be able to go up to him and go, how long did you go to college to learn it?
I went 7 years. Studied Greek for 7 years to learn that.
And go, really, I learned that in a half an hour. Are you slow? And so, and the kick is, this is one of the easiest things there is to do. There, it gets a little harder. There, you don't actually even have to know Greek to correct the Bible with Greek. Now, that's the amazing thing. And so, I'll show you how it's done. There are three different ways to do it. And what we're going to do is we're going to show you how it's done. And remember this, and this is one of the things you have to remember. Whenever somebody gives you something that you go, wow, that looks like there's really a problem with the King James Bible. You ever heard this? I didn't lie, I only told a half truth. The rest of that story is, but it's usually the wrong half. Okay? And so usually when you are impressed, like, oh, you know, that guy, when he shows it that way, it really looks like there's a problem with my Bible. It is because he has not shown you everything. So I call this the Greek game. I'll show you how to correct the Bible. Then I'll show you this in action. I'll show you exactly how it's done. Games. Do games, you know what games need? They need rules. Games need rules. I mean, if you don't have rules to a game, you play by one rule. In fact, kids, you know, ever see kids play and they start making up rules as they go? If you get into a dispute with a mentally handicapped anti-fundy or whatever on Twitter, they jump on me and I just chew them up. And then they start saying, oh, well, you're not allowed to do that. And I go, well, what? I said, well, you the official Twitter rule maker, you know, because it's kind of like you get into a fight and when you're on the bottom of the guy's hammer, you go, oh, well, you're not allowed to use your right hand. So here's the nice thing about the Greek game. Here's what I like about games. There are some games I'd like to play, but it would take me 3 years to learn them because of all the parameters and all the rules. There is only one rule with the Greek game, and this is not an overstatement. It's not something to be dramatic. There is one rule with the Greek game, and if you get this rule down, you can always look intelligent. And that is, now this isn't true, but this is the rule of the game. The King James Bible is always wrong. If you keep that in mind, you can always look good, okay? And we'll give you guys, just to give you a thought, all right? You men, imagine you got a guest coming over your house, and your wife cooks her best dinner. And she makes her cinnamon rolls and all of the best stuff that she does. And this guy wants to impress you with what he knows about cooking. So during the dinner, he looks at your wife and says, you know, this is very good, but you know, if you cook this roast about 50 degrees cooler for a half hour longer, it probably wouldn't be dry. Oh, and about the blandness of your potatoes, if you just add a little salt while you're boiling the potatoes, they wouldn't be so bland. And about the lumps in your gravy, guys, there'd be some lumps, would there not? He wants to impress you with what he knows about cooking. I say it this way, he better know something about first aid, okay? If a guy did that to your wife at the dinner table, would you go, wow, you really know something about cooking? You would not. You'd say, you come in here and you do that? And yet, to show us what they know about the Bible, guys stand in churches behind the pulpit with God's book and go, now, if God would have just done this, it might have been a better book. Okay? So don't be impressed when somebody carves your Bible up in an effort to look good. All right, the first one, and I told you there's three ways to do this. The first one, this is the simplest. Just get a Bible commentary. Now, basically, any will do. Ruckman's won't, mine won't. And there's probably one or two out there that won't, but here's what I mean. Just about any Bible commentary that you get. It can even be by a King James Bible believer, usually. But just about any Bible... Oh, I'm supposed to show you some books to sell. Hang on a second. Can I do that? That's our catalog. That's free. This is the first book I did. This is the master's thesis. That's third edition. And as big as it is, don't be intimidated. That really is understandable. I tell people this... Philadelphia, I preach in this church in the Philly area, and this guy's 71-year-old Roman Catholic grandmother got saved and said, where did we get the Bible from anyway? And they gave her that. And she promptly broke a hip trying to pick it up. But, no, they said about 2-3 months later, she's coming in telling them what she learned from Bible history. So it is pretty well informative. And that one and this one usually go, that we're just in the process, just did... See if I can get this right. This one just went into the, well, it's actually the 8th printing, third printing of the third edition. We're printing this right now. It's the 10th reprint. That's the second book. And that just covers 62 charges that they bring against your King James Bible. I get this a lot. I just had this. This is a good one for college students. We got a kid going to college. And this young lady came to me and she said, I sat in my King James Bible Believing Bible College, okay? You're a fool, parents, if you call the school and say, oh, we believe the King James, do you? You really think a Bible college is going to go, send your student here and we'll show them what's wrong with their Bible? Here's what they do. They will say anything they have to get you to send the kid, and when they hang up the phone, whoever's in the room, they'll go, huh, we'll straighten that kid up when they get here. And so this young lady came in, I get this, it's either a young man or a young lady, and she said, my college professor said, here's the problem with the King James Bible. And she said, I didn't interrupt him because I don't teach people to cause problems. She said, I just went back to my dorm after the class, pulled this down off the shelf, looked at the table of contents to what his charge was, and found the scriptural answer for it. I tell you, that's been around since 89, nothing in that book has been refuted. And it has been. They've taken some shots at it. So that one may be good. This is a new book. I'd not write it. When I leave here Saturday, I'm with you first, right? Sunday through Wednesday, and then Thursday through Sunday, I'm going to be with this pastor, Kyle Stevens. The Certainty of the Words. This is over 800 pages on the supremacy of the English text, okay? I had somebody tell me that they read this, and we get a lot of positive comments about it, that is the best book written on the King James Bible. Stupid book. Anyway, I tell people this. I guarantee this. That book will stop a Bible corrector in their tracks. If you can get them right about the bridge of the nose. But I love to do that to a Bible corrector. But anyway, so those are back there. And my wife, who is apparently out watching the World Series of Poker now. I don't see her. But she'll be back there to take your money. Okay, that's a news ad. That's the advertisement. If you get any Bible commentary at all, you're going to teach on a passage. It could be Romans, it could be Matthew, whatever it is. If it's Old Testament, they'll do the Hebrew. If it's New Testament, they'll do the Greek. And you'll be going down through this commentary, and tomorrow you're going to be going through verses 1 through 8 to your Sunday school class. And if you go to any Bible commentary, the guy will say, now, the word translated this way in your King James Bible is the Greek word such and such, and it should have been translated this way. Let me explain something, guys. I want to illustrate that I say this, and I don't say this, to be overstatement. All right, this is my Bible, okay? And let's say this is a Greek grammar book. Now, I take a word out of that, and I go to the Greek grammar book, and I start studying meanings. Can I ask you a question? Am I studying the Bible? How can I be studying something that's not even in the room with me? All right? Greek study is not Bible study. It can't be. I say, here's what I call it. It is lazy man's Bible study. Because instead of reading your Bible and spending time in it and checking verse with verse and actually having to talk to the author, you just go to the Greek. You just go to the Greek. So if you don't know any Greek whatsoever, and nowadays, because of computers, with cut and paste, you don't even have to copy the notes. You can just go on your computer, get the Bible commentary, go to that passage, cut and paste, throw it in your notes, get up the next day and go, now, beloved, the Greek word translated this way in our dear King James Bible, and you know I love the King James Bible. It should have been translated this way, and I know, because here's why. And they're going to go, wow, I didn't know that my plumber knew Greek. Right? And that's it. In fact, what you get from here will be how they got it is going to be point two and three. I was at a talent contest. That's a nice spiritual thing for a bunch of churches to have. And they're having this talent contest amongst these young people, and this 14-year-old boy got up. How many 14-year-olds do you think know Greek in this country? I mean, unless you're born in Athens, okay? And this kid got up and said, now the Greek word translated this way should have been translated this way. Now, where do you think that 14, you really think that 14-year-old kid knew Greek so well that he was reading his Greek New Testament and went, oh, look, the King James translators dropped the ball. 47 idiots couldn't get it right, but me, the 14-year-old genius, I will square it away. So all you have to do is get a Bible commentary, cut and paste it into your notes, your Sunday school notes. When you get up the next day, just read what the guy says, and everyone will think you're intelligent. That is all you have to do. I could stop there, but I told you I was going to go a little farther. I said there's going to be three. There's actually four. All right, the second one. The second is get a Greek lexicon. Now, this is not a little short red-haired guy from Ireland, okay? A lexicon. We all know what a dictionary is. Dictionary is, I get a word, I want to know what the meaning of that word is or the multiple meanings. That is not what a lexicon is. A lexicon is, here is a word, and here are the ways that it can be translated, okay? Here's a Greek word. It can be translated slow. It can be translated meandering. It can be translated my brother. Anyway, slow. But So what you're doing, you're translating into the Greek, from the Greek into the English, and you come to a word and you go, gee, what are the choices that I have? Now, we're going to be studying a Greek word, and I want you to see it. I love all the colors. I just do. I love all the colors. We're going to be studying the Greek word Anna. Let's see. It's been so long since I did this. Yeah, anaphero. Okay. Transliterated, it would be anaphero. Okay. So if you went to a lexicon, now obviously you'd have to know enough Greek to be able to identify the word. But if you went to a lexicon, and I use the analytical Greek lexicon, I made that statement on a TV roundtable discussion against some anti-King James guys, and this guy just went, whoa, that's 100 years old. Why would you use that? It seems to me almost one of the best recommendations. I'm pretty sure the word sodomy does not appear in the present Webster's dictionary. So why would you get one that has so changed the meanings of our words? Isn't that why we go to the 1828? So an older lectionary, a lexicon would be better. The Greek word anaphero can be translated six different ways. It can be translated to bear. It can be translated to carry upwards. It can be translated to lead up. It can be translated to offer. To bear aloft. And it can be translated to sustain. Now, that's basically the six ways that that word can be translated. Now, what is the rule of the Greek game? I told you, King James Bible is always wrong. Okay, so, it doesn't matter how the King James translators used this word or translated this word. They were wrong. That's what you have to keep in mind. So what that means is, you come to a place where the King James translators chose way number one, to bear. And all you have to do, and I've heard them do it, you've heard them do it. The guy goes, now, beloved, I love our dear King James Bible, but you know, this is one of those sad places in our Bible where the King James translators, could I tell you something about the King James translators? At age 14, they were speaking Greek, and when these guys debated opponents, they publicly debated them in Greek. These are Englishmen, okay? And so the guys that are criticizing your Bible don't have a handle on it like they did. But anyway, you say, it's so sad that our King James translators translated this word in this passage to bear, because it's kind of like, did you ever just put up with something? I have to go to the dentist. I have to bear this. Oh, somebody I don't like is here, and I just have to bear it. And it's so sad because you see, this word could also be translated to sustain. And isn't that so much better? For you see, our dear Lord doesn't just bear with us, but He sustains us. Who sustains you? The one that brings you your food, the one that brings you your water, the one that supplies your house, the one that puts the clothes on your back. Now, can you see what I'm doing? And that is all you got to do. Just pick any one of the five and talk about it. But wait a minute. 3 pages later, you hit the word again, and the King James translators chose to sustain. Is that right? After you just spent 15 minutes telling everybody how right it is. Is it right?
Nope.
It can't be right. Because the King James Bible is what? Always wrong. That it is always wrong. So now they translate it to sustain and go, well, you know, I mean, that's like the guy that just brings the supplies to the tent. But you know what we need? We need a leader. And that Bible, that word could have been translated to lead. And guys, you say, well, preacher, that is not how it is. That is exactly how it is. I am telling you that is exactly how it is done. I remember hearing this guy preach, and it was a revelation, because he'd come to this word and he'd say, now the King James translators translated it this way, should have been this way. Then he'd go, now the word here, and I go, yeah, it's wrong. And he'd go, it's wrong, and he'd tell why. And then he comes in and he says, you know where the Bible says, and their carcasses fell in the wilderness or something like that? And he goes, no, that word carcasses. And I thought, okay, now it's wrong. And he goes, that is so descriptive of what happened. It wasn't just bodies, but it was their... And I thought, he's right, but he could have done that in every other point back there too, right? See, when he got to a word he liked, he exalted it. But to show he was a genius, and you got to be a genius. Guys, is God the smartest being in the universe? Well, then if you can correct him, what's that make you? Right? So, it is indeed all ego. Now, if you don't know Greek well enough to use a lexicon, then know Greek well enough to use the concordance. I use the Young's Analytical Concordance, and here's what it has. It not only, you know what a concordance does. you're looking for the word carcass. You're looking for the word carcass. So you go under, like a dictionary, you find the word carcass. And here's what the Young's Analytical Concordance does. You'll see the word carcass. It'll tell you what the Greek word is. And then it'll say 29, have a number 29 in parentheses or something like that. What that means is that word appears 29 times. And then it'll tell you every place. But in the back of the Young's, and I don't know if the others do this, but in the back of the Young's analytical concordance, you can look up that Greek word. It'll say this Greek word appears 29 times, and it does not, like a lexicon, tell you the ways it can be translated, but it tells you how many times and which ways it was translated in your King James Bible. Example, the word anaphero appears in your King James Bible 10 times, okay? Not 11, not 9, 10 times. So if you look up anaphero in the back of the Young's Concordance, and you say, how do you know? Because that's how I got this lesson. If you look up the word anaphero in the back of the Young's Concordance, here's what you'll come up with. It appears 10 times. It was translated to bear, and you'll see that these will pretty much correspond with what you got here, because remember, when they were translating, they went to something like this to get their choices. So remember, to bear is one of the options. Well, King James translators twice translated on a pharaoh to bear. It was translated to bring up once. It was translated to carry up once. It was translated lead up once. Translated offer two times. And by the way, the Young's Analytical will also give you the scripture references where these appear. So for lead up, it would have the verse. Lead up is Mark chapter 9, verse 2. Carry up is Luke chapter 24, verse 51. So you can even go to the passage. And it's translated offer up three times. So if you count them up, you got 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You got 10, 10 times that the Greek word anaphero appeared. Now, here's all you've got to do. When you come to some place, and what you do here is the same thing you did here. If you come to where the Bible says, again, I like that word bear. So you say, well, look, you know, our King James translators translated it to bear. Now, you know that I love the King James Bible. Guys, when those guys say that, you know, when if you, I mean, that's like saying, honey, I love you, and don't pay any attention to this knife in my hands. And so you see, beloved, they translated to bear. And that is just as though somebody was just bearing with somebody. But, you know, the Bible says that it could be translated to carry up. And, in fact, the King James translators even translated it once, carry up. And is that not really our Lord? You know, like a child on the back, like the lamb across the shoulders of the shepherd, our Lord carries us. Well, couldn't I say the same thing about to bear? Yeah. Say, then why wouldn't I? Because that's the one they chose. I'm going to talk about to bear when I get to carry. You understand? That's all you got to do. Guys, that is all you have to do. And then the third one, or fourth one, and you don't need any Greek for this, you just need to go out and buy, again, looks about like this. You need to buy a Greek English interlinear New Testament. What that means, all right? Interlinear means between the lines, correct? Say yes. Okay. What that means is this. I saw a guy, because I flew, I can't bring my stuff with me. I have them in the back of my truck. I've got this paper-backed Greek interlinear. It's kind of the color of her T-shirt, that kind of an aqua color. If I brought it to the pulpit here, you'd go, that's not a Bible. And what it is, it's a New Testament. It's about this thick, and here's what it does. On one side, it gives you the King James text on one page. Like on this page, it's always the King James text. On this page, it's the Greek. Mind you, it's usually the wrong Greek. In other words, they won't give you the King James and the Textus Receptus Greek. They'll give you the King James and the critical text, which was not used on the King James. So you know you're going to have problems. Like you could go, so you know, you ignore Acts chapter, the guy, the teacher, he says now Acts chapter 8, verse 37 doesn't belong in the Bible. And you come up and say, now wait a minute, that belongs to the Bible. And he goes, well, look here. There's the Greek, and it's not in there. And you go, wow, I saw it myself. You got conned. Remember, I told you, half truth, and you got halved. So here's what they do. They put the King James English here, the Greek over here, wrong Greek, and then under each line of Greek, they do a literal translation for each word. Now, I saw a guy had one just like this. It was leather bound. It wasn't hard bound. It was maroon like that. It was gilt edge pages, ribbon markers, and when you saw him carry it, you thought, that guy's got a whole Bible. He didn't. He had a Greek New Testament because it's thicker because of this all this stuff they're doing. And so you think the guy's got a Bible, and you don't have to have it in your notes. You can have it off the top of your head. You can go, and you know something, beloved? You know, this isn't in my notes, but you know, the word translated this way in our King James Bible actually is a glaring flaw because that word literally means, and you're looking at it right here, and they think you got it here. One of the things I tell people, and I know this sounds simplistic, but it is a fact. If you paid $70,000 for a red sports car, you know where you'd park it? Where everybody could see it. Right? Yeah, that's mine. Yeah, I said, I didn't want to drive the blue one today. Right? So if you pay that kind of money for, come on, you pay, you know, big bucks for a house, you want people to see it. You pay big money for something, you want people to see it. What do you do when you take $70,000 and put it between your ears in an education? I mean, I go to Bible college to find out what's wrong with the Bible, and you're not going to know. So I always say it this way, every now and then you got to show them your brain. And you go, now, beloved, you know, you bumpkins who don't know Greek like I do, and don't have $70,000 in the Bible, I got $70,000 in my brain, unlike you. And that's what they do. Every now and then, they just peel their brain out and go, I just want to sell you. And then they put it back in, and they do that. Guys, that's all you got to do. That is absolutely all you have to do. Either get a Bible commentary and let whoever infidel teacher is correct your Bible for you. Learn enough Greek to use the lexicon, and you can do some of your own. Get a concordance, a Young's Analytical, and it'll do it for you. Or get a Greek-English interlinear New Testament, and that's it. And I'm done, and I bet it didn't take a half an hour to teach you how to correct the Bible. But we're also going to do this. One of the things, I'm not a big deal about degrees. And the reason I went on for mine was very simple. Isn't it amazing? Well, I'll show you something. I'm going to give you two titles here. Now, you get these guys, they get ordained and they go, well, I don't want to be called reverend. You know, like they're so pious. Every guy who says that will use that to get into a hospital or jail. If you get ordained at some point, you're gonna use that reverend, okay? Now I'm not telling you to call people reverend. I am just telling you. Well, here, let me explain it this way. You have two titles here, reverend and doctor. Now, doctor can be what? Can be a medical doctor, can be a veterinary doctor, can be a dentist, can be a chiropractor, but it's a doctor. It's a medical. So this one is an educational title, doctor of theology, doctor of philosophy. Correct? So which one of these is an educational or earthly title, and which one is associated with heaven? Come on. Reverend. Reverend is associated with heaven. And you love God, right? So of those two titles, which one of those should carry the most weight with you? It ought to be reverend. And it doesn't. Because we're Gentiles. And we worship education. We worship education. Yes, we do. And here's how bad it is. Reverend can study this subject or any other subject. Let's say he studies this subject. Reverend Smith looks into this for 30 years and is convinced the King James Bible is the Word of God. Doctor. Now, I don't even mind honorary doctor's degrees because they're an honor. I had a student of mine just recently got an honorary DD. But here's what I tell people about an honorary doctor's degree. It's like an honorary black belt in karate. wear it around the house. But you go outside and try to use it, hey, you're going to get yourself hurt. How many of you saw The Wizard of Oz? What did the scarecrow want? He wanted a brain. Did he ever get a brain? He got a diploma. Right? The guy never got a, he never went to college. He never got a degree. And the guy said, well, you don't need a college education. Why, you just need a certificate. And they hand him this piece of paper. And he goes, oh, e pluribus unum. Oh, 2 + 2 = 4. I mean, all of a sudden, he got a piece of paper and everybody thought he was educated. Yeah. And he didn't get a brain. He got an honorary degree. So here you got this guy. And I'll tell you how you get the honorary degree. It's the simplest thing in the world. If you're a pastor, send all of your teenage students going to Bible college to the same Bible college you went to. And they will recognize what a great man of God you are, and they'll give you an honorary doctor's degree. And so here's Reverend. For 30 years, he has studied this subject out and concludes the King James Bible is the Word of God. Here's Doctor, who hasn't studied it at all. But he sent 25 students to his college, and they gave him an honorary doctor's degree. And you have a question about the King James Bible, whether it's the Word of God or not. And Reverend, from his experience, tells you, oh man, it is the Word of God. And the doctor who doesn't have the experience and hasn't done the study says, no, it's got mistakes in it. You know what you're going to say? Well, I know what the Reverend said, but Dr. So-and-so said it has mistakes because we worship education. So what I did is I said, okay, if you're going to reverence somebody's doctor's degree, you're going to reverence mine. And so back in 1980, I got the first one. Somebody asked me, I said, how many doctor's degrees do you have? I said, I have two of them. You heard about me. I'm a paradox. But because that unloads the gun. I knew if I was going to be reverend and somebody says there's a mistake in the King James Bible, and I said, no, it doesn't, and I study all of this out, and I go, yeah, but he's a doctor and you're just a reverend. So I unloaded that gun. And what that did is that gave me the right, and I claim the right, and I will fight over my rights. That gave me the right to correct the Bible with the best of them. So I can play the game. I can officially play the game. And we're going to play the game. I want you to go. I'll show you how this can be done. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 17. And in Matthew chapter 17, I'm going to show you how they might play the game, and then I'm going to play the game. And here's the amazing thing. These guys make the rules. You know what the rule is? What's the rule? So if they go to the Greek and correct the Bible, they're okay. If I go to the Greek and correct the Bible, they won't like the way I do it. By the way, to prove my point about the King James Bible always being wrong, this happened a number of years ago. I don't document this stuff, and I really probably should. I'm sitting in a congregation at a conference. I'm not one of the speakers. And this guy, I can still remember, though, he was in Romans chapter 8, this preacher, and he reads down to a verse, and he gets to a word, and he did the act. He did exactly what, oh, I am telling you. Let's get the pizzas ready. Anyway, he gets to this word in a verse and says this, now, beloved. Watch that. I am serious. That beloved stuff. When they say, our dear Lord, beloved, and our dear King James Bible, you better check their hands. They've got a very sharp knife in their hand. And they're saying, beloved, beloved. Okay? And this guy says, now, beloved, this is one of those places that as much as I love our King James Bible, this is one of those places where the King James translators made an error. And then he proceeded. I don't know what word it was, but he proceeded where they had said this. He said this. And he spent 15 minutes showing you that he was smarter than God. And he did it. So this happened the very next day. For some strange reason, I'm listening to Christian radio. And this guy on the radio is reading from Romans chapter 8, same chapter. Reads down to the same verse. Reads down to the same word. Now yesterday, this guy said, the King James translators translated it this way. And they should have translated it this way. And if you sat there, you'd go, wow, he knows what he's talking about. So now the guy on the radio says, now, beloved. And he just, the same speech. I love our King James Bible. But this is one of those places where the King James translators translated it this way. And I said, I know, it ought to be translated this way. And he said, and it ought to be translated this way. And he picked a different one than that. Now, you say, well, who's wrong? Doesn't matter who's wrong. King James Bible's always wrong. Both of those guys had a different choice. And you know what that gives me? That gives me not two choices. See, I now have to make a decision. And I don't have two to choose from. I have four to choose from. You know what they are? I can believe the guy that I heard last night who signed my Bible. He did not sign my Bible, you understand? But I can believe the guy last night that signed my Bible. Or I can believe the guy on the radio that I send my tithe to instead of giving it where it belongs in my church. So I can. He's a choice, or he's a choice. Or the third choice, and this is the one most people take. Well, I like Dr. So-and-so in Romans chapter 8. But I like the other guy on the radio in Romans chapter 9. And I like someone else in Romans chapter 10. So now I am God. Or the fourth choice is, just forget all of them, including you, and stick with the King James Bible. So look at Matthew chapter 17. Matthew chapter 17, and look at verse 1. He's going to study here this. Matthew chapter 17, and after verse 1, after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into an high mountain apart. Now, I'm going to be a fundamentalist for a minute. This is very painful for me. Here's how it goes. Beloved, now you know that I wouldn't use a modern translation. You know that I love our King James Bible. But I hate to say it, but this is one of those sad places in our King James Bible where, try as they might, those 47 translators, far more educated than me, could not get this right. But because I'm going to show you what is wrong with this passage. And the Greek word translated, you see the words, bringeth them up. And this is fact, guys. Look here. You see where it says, hang on a second. He might have. Oh, bring up. I can't read my own note. That's the word bring. Here, let me make that look like a B. Okay, that feel better now. You remember I told you the Young's Concordance tells you how many times it was translated a certain way, and it was translated one time, bring up. This is Matthew chapter 17, verse 1. And so, beloved, the Greek word translated there is the Greek word anaphera. Now, I wouldn't expect any of you lunkheads to understand it, but I have $70,000 in my brain, so I can do it. And though it can be translated bring up, it can also be translated to carry up. For you see, to bring up, I mean, you can say, I bring in the groceries, but when you say the word carry, I mean, we don't bring a baby, we carry the baby. We don't bring an injured person, we support them, we carry them. We've all seen situations where a wounded soldier was carried by his fellow soldiers. Now, you see what I'm doing? I am just making a beautiful graphic picture of my choice of the word. And so you see, brethren, as much as I love the King James Bible, it says bringeth them up, but it should have said carry them up. And now I'm done. And you're going to go, wow, he really knows something about the Bible. He knows something about conning you. Now, I am going to play the game my way. Since I'm allowed, I'm going to play the game my way. Beloved, you see that word bringeth them up. Now, I wouldn't expect you guys, inferior education that you have, and me having in my brain, unlike you, you wouldn't know what I'm about to show you. But the Greek word there is the Greek word anaphero. And even though our King James translators, bring up was a choice, although it really wasn't a choice from the concordance, that word could also be translated lead up or offer. And because of the King James translators, you all missed the deeper meaning and the true meaning of this verse. The Lord wasn't just bringing them to a mountaintop, but he was leading them up to offer them as a human sacrifice to God. Where are you going? How can you say that? I can say that. I absolutely can, because lead up and offer are a choice, and one time it was translated lead up, and five times it was translated to offer up. Now, guys, you say, well, he wasn't going to do a human sacrifice. You know that, and I know that. But you see what you can do with the Greek? That is what you can do with the Greek. Now, to show you how far you can go. I have asked Brother Brandon to, Helmut brought me in his new King James that he studies out of. And so it did bother me. It did bother me, all the fresh notes I saw in it. But I'm going to show you how this works. Come on up here, preacher. And I want you to open up to Acts. Go to your Bibles, Acts chapter 3. Hey, you have to come over on my right side. They'll pick you up on a mic, and you'll be out of the camera. We don't want you on camera. I get on camera.
Acts
chapter 3 comes after Acts chapter 2. Yeah, let's hope. Acts chapter 3, and I'm not going to read the entire verse, but I'll read to one point, and then you can read the same portion of the verse. We're going to look at four verses here. Acts chapter 3, verse 13. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his Son, Jesus. Let me ask you a question, by the way. Was Jesus the Son of God?
Yep.
Okay. So it says his Son, Jesus. Read that portion out of the New King James.
The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant, Jesus.
All right, so Jesus just lost his sonship, correct? Now, don't you dare come up and go, well, I can still find the sonship of Jesus in 200 places, other places in the New King James. And I can find it 201 in my King James. Now, would you like $200 or $201?
Well, servant is...
Yeah, hang on, let me get that. So, look at verse 26. Unto you first, God, having raised up his Son, Jesus. Go ahead.
To you first, God, having raised up his servant, Jesus.
All right, now Jesus lost his sonship twice. Look at chapter 4, verse 27. For of a truth against thy holy child, Jesus. Go ahead.
What was it?
4:27.
For truly against your holy servant, Jesus.
And verse 30. By stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus.
By stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant Jesus.
Okay, have a seat, and I'm gonna explain what just happened here. Now, four times Jesus Christ lost his sonship. Twice he was called son, that was removed, changed to servant. Twice he was called child, and that was changed to servant also. So four times the son or the child became the servant, right? All right, now, before I show you this, what did I tell you when these guys tell you the truth? What do they do? Half-truth. All right? Now, I'm going to dazzle you, okay? Beloved. Watch out. Beloved. You know, Dr. Gipp complains about the translation of the New King James Version in those four verses, but what Dr. Gipp doesn't tell you is he doesn't tell you what the Greek witness is. For you see, the Greek word for son is huios, and that is not the Greek word that appears in any of those four chapters, those four verses. The Greek word for child is technon, and I hate to tell you, but me, having those of a head, can tell you that the Greek word is not technon. So the Greek word in that those four verses is neither huios, son, or technon, child. But it is a Greek word, paida. And that is the Greek word for servant. And Dr. Gipp tries to convince you that there are four mistakes in your New King James Version when the Greek bears witness that the King James translators made four erroneous translations. Now, guys, you know if I shut this lesson down and sent you out of here right now, as much as your King James translator, some of you'd have a problem, wouldn't you? Because you go, well, I did. I mean, he even showed it. But I told you, it's how much of the truth?
Half
truth. If anybody here has ever had any Greek study, does anybody know what this word is? The Greek word for doulos, the Greek word doulos, anybody know? It's the Greek word for slave or servant. Now, at least tell me that somebody's brain is gone, wait a minute, you just gave me two Greek words for the word servant, right? I mean, is your brain waking up a little bit? All right, do you know what it means when it says a dedicated word? A dedicated word. A dedicated, well, I'll give you an example. A dedicated, the dedicated Greek word for son is huios. In other words, if it's huios, you know what you translate it? Son. If it's the word technon, it's the dedicated word for child. Paida is not a dedicated word. Doulos is the dedicated word. In other words, technon, you're going to translate it child. Doulos, you're going to translate it slave or servant. But paida has a multiple choice of meanings. And I'm going to give these to you, and I'm going to give them to you in the exact order that they are in my analytical Greek lexicon. This paida comes from the Greek word paios. All right? That's the Greek word, that's the root word. And here's the choices. When it comes through the lexicon, here's the choices that you can translate paios. Child. That's the first one they gave. Does anybody see anything here? Wasn't chapter 4, verse 27 and 30, didn't it say your child Jesus? So already half of their charges against King James Bible have been negated, correct? All right. It can be translated child, youth, boy, girl, maiden, servant, slave, attendant, and minister. Now, you see that it's a more general term, and you can pick, right? But child is one of the choices. So why did they remove child from your Bible? Now, let me tell you, I taught this for years, and I would prophesy. I would come to this part of this lesson, and here's what I would prophesy. I would say this. If you showed this to a New King James guy, you know what he'd do? All right, let me ask. He'd say this. Well, he's right. Dr. Gipp is right. Pios can be translated child, but does anyone see the word son in the choices? Is it there? You know why it's not there? Because it's not a choice. So you do indeed have two erroneous translations in your King James Bible in Acts chapter 3, verse 13 and 26, right? See what I'm saying? Now, I used to prophesy that that's what they would do. And in 1995, I was on the John Ankerberg television program doing a national roundtable debate, discussion, whatever the case may be. Eight of us, John Ankerberg is sitting here, four guys on each side. This was Ken Barker, head of the NIV committee. This was Joseph Chambers from Paul Creek Ministries, Bible believer. Next to him was James White, alias Snow. Next to Chambers was Sam Gipp. Next to him was Art Farstad, head of the New King James Translation, who, I will say this, I have nothing negative to say about Art Farstad. I believe he was saved. Here's what I think. He was an anti-critical text guy. And he's more like Bergen, okay? Except that if we were alive with Bergen, we wouldn't be on the same side. We use his stuff now because he's not here to say there are mistakes in the Bible. This is what I believe. I believe Farstad thought, you know, this King James is pretty good, but it does have some flaws. And so we're going to, with these King James guys, when we bring out this new King James, they are going to so thank us. And we screamed at him instead. And next to him was, next to me on my left side, was Thomas Strauss, a TR man, not a Bible believer, a representative of Donald Waite. And then far guy back here on the right, fourth guy back is Don Wilkins. He was working on the new American Standard Version. And on this side was Dan Wallace. Daniel Wallace is probably one of the world's most eminent scholars, textual critics. Dan Wallace wasn't even supposed to be in the program. He was not on the list. They surprised us with him, and I'm going to tell you why, because they wanted me to go on and answer for Peter Ruckman. Guys, you can't answer for anybody else. You can't answer for me. If somebody reads my book and says, well, Gipp says this in his book, and you're going to go, oh, that's kind of dumb. But that's because I got to defend myself. All right? You try to defend me, you're going to look like a fool. And they got Joseph Chambers to try to defend Gail Ripplinger. He failed miserably. They were going to get me to try to defend Dr. Ruckman, as though Ruckman would say something stupid. And that would have negated me, and they were going to chew up the TR guy. They were going to absolutely eat him alive, and he didn't even know it. So Ankerberg himself and his program manager called me 2 weeks before the program and said, "Now, you don't mind answering questions for Dr. Ruckman." I said, "I'm not his representative." "No, I don't. I'm not answering for him." That meant they had to face the answer book and the understandable history. Ankerberg bought, at that time, 2 copies of every book that I wrote and passed them out amongst these guys, realized they couldn't refute the stuff, and called in Dan Wallace as their emergency heavy hitter. All right, so here's how this goes. Ankerberg has this, he has a couple of these verses. I think it's Acts chapter 3, verse 13, maybe Acts chapter 4, verse 30. He has one of those four verses, two of those four verses, just like that. He has on a piece of paper this big, because it's got to be picked up on camera. He has it from a King James, where it says, "Thy holy son Jesus, thy holy child Jesus." And then he reads it from a new King James, and it says, "Thy holy child, or thy holy servant Jesus." And he goes, very smug. Now, most people don't have a problem with that, but Dr. Gipp does. What is the problem with this, Dr. Gipp? Now, guys, there are times when you just really do well to act like you just came in on a load of pumpkins. And that's exactly what I did. Rather than tell him anything of this, I just went with my best, just came in from Tennessee. They put shoes on me so I could do the TV program. "Well, that New King James, it 4 times, it takes the deity of Jesus Christ right out of the Bible. That's a mistake." And when I did that, I walked right into their trap. And so he goes, "Well, we have the head of the New King James Committee, Dr. Art Farstad here. Dr. Farstad, could you explain why you did that?" And Farstad said the Greek word, he did this. He said the Greek word translated there, servant, is the Greek word paida. It's not the Greek word for child. It's not the Greek word for son. And he gave the half-truth. And then I said, I gave this. I said, "But doulos is a Greek word for servant. Pios can be translated that. Child is one of the choices." And I knew I was leaving myself open to what he said next. I mean, he is reading my script. He is following exactly as I said they would do. He said, "But son is not a choice." Guys, is son a choice? It is not a choice. Then you must have a mistake in your King James Bible. You must have 2 mistakes in your King James Bible. Let me ask you a question. Are there any mistakes in your King James Bible? Then there's got to be an explanation. Come on up, preacher. I want you to go to John chapter 4. John chapter 4. You got this nobleman, and his son is dying, and he goes to the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 49, "The nobleman saith unto him, Sir, come down ere my child die. Jesus saith unto him," John chapter 4, verse 49 and 50, that's where we're at. "Jesus saith unto him, Go thy way, thy son liveth. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, Thy son liveth." You see verse 51 where it says, "Thy son liveth"? Look up here. The Greek word, the Greek word that is translated son in that verse is not huios. It isn't technon. It's Pida. Now, is there any doubt that it was his son? It's his son, right? And so the King James translators put in son because it was his son. Now, watch what the translators that 4 times used. It's not the Greek word for son. It's not the Greek word for child. 4 times they used that to take the sonship away from Jesus Christ. Read verse 51 in the New King James, preacher.
"Now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, Your son lives."
Why, isn't that amazing? They have no Greek authority for that translation whatsoever, correct? Now, you have a contextual authority, meaning it's obvious it's his son, right? But they did the New King James translators just translate paida with a word that wasn't even a choice? And they don't mind doing that for the son, for a lost nobleman. But they wouldn't do it 4 times for the Son of God. And I nailed Art Farstad on it. I mean, undressed him. And you know what happened? It happened every single time. Every time we'd put one of those guys on the barn door, Hank, as I'm nailing their hide to the barn door, in rides Ankerberg and just steered the conversation away. So you see, guys, it's always half-truth. Thank you very much, preacher. So it is always a half-truth. Let me explain something. There are no mistakes in your King James Bible.
That's right.
And the King James Bible is always right. It is not always wrong. And I just wanted you to see this because I wanted you to see just how they do it. Don't ever be impressed with a magician. Well, be, you know, enjoy the show. Enjoy the show. I mean, I enjoy a magician. And even though I can't, and here's what you got to remember. Have you ever seen a magician and you were entertained and you know what he just did? He didn't really cut somebody in half, right? But you don't know how he got it, how he did it, right?
Yep.
That's how you look at these guys. Wow. It sure looks real, but I know that this book is always right, so I know what I just saw didn't happen. It's an illusion, and you just learned how to do it. One of four ways: Bible commentary, lexicon, concordance, or Greek, English, New Testament. All right, let's have a little word of prayer. We'll take about a 5-minute break, and we'll come back and we'll extend this study a little bit. We're talking about the Vietnam War. I always say this in a couple of things. Let's go back. Gettysburg. Now, if you're from the South, I'm glad, but we beat you. And I worry about people who lost a fight and didn't know it. I think the Iraqis, that's where they're at. But let me tell you what Gettysburg was. Gettysburg was the best shot that the South had, and they lost. And I always say this: if you can take the best punch that your opposition has, can you imagine? You get to fight this guy, and you get the first punch, and he's going to stand there with his hands in his pockets, and you get to nail this guy with everything you got. So you walk up to him, and you go, bam! And he goes, are you done? In case you didn't know, you're done. All right? And so... In the Civil War, that was the best shot the South had, and they were done. The tide of the South only receded after Gettysburg, because that was the best chance they had. From Gettysburg, they were going to go to the Potomac, they were going to invade Washington, D.C., and it did not happen. In December of 1944, by that time, actually nobody knew it at that time, but the World War II in Europe was 6 months from being over. And it was a bitter cold war, a bitter cold winter, and basically the line had stagnated. The Germans weren't attacking, the Americans weren't attacking. It's below zero. And then one morning, I believe it was the 19th of December, the Germans hadn't been flying, they hadn't been dropping bombs, they hadn't been lobbing artillery shells, and it was obvious they were out of ammunition, they were out of aviation fuel, they were out of bombs, and they weren't. They were hoarding them. They were stockpiling them. And on December 19th, it was kind of one of those ice fogs, you know. All of a sudden, the Americans heard the sound of tanks. And out of the fog came these panzers, and they slammed into the American line. And what Hitler's plan was is he was going to, in the famous Blitzkrieg, he was going to break through the Allied line, pivot north and south, roll up the line. He had no hope of winning. But he thought he could so set back our war effort that once he did that, it would take it set the war back a couple of years, and he could sue for good surrender terms. And so he slammed into the line, drove it back. Actually, he went around the city of Bastogne, France. He surrounded it. It never surrendered. But that became known as because the line did not break, but the line came down and had a salient there. It had a bulge that became known as the Battle of the Bulge. That was the best shot they had, and they lost. 3 days, and the amazing thing was Eisenhower, who was the chief Allied commander, supreme Allied commander, he had all of his generals together and said, how long will it take to get relief there? And one guy says, it'll take a month. Another guy says, well, gee, man, it's going to take us 3 weeks. And Patton says, 3 days. He said, 3 days? How are you going to do it in 3 days? He said, we already planned for this. And he was there in 3 days. In Vietnam in 1968, in January, was known as the Tet Offensive. And here was Vietnam. And all along the border of South Vietnam, the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese regular army attacked the South. To this day, because of the press, because the press has always been against our country, people think that the Tet was a victory and was a defeat for us and a victory for the communists. It was one of the most devastating defeats they ever had. The communists were so devastatingly defeated that the Viet Cong in Vietnam, they were southern. They were South Vietnamese who were communists. The NVA, the North Vietnamese Army, was from the north. So the Viet Cong were the guerrillas. The North Vietnamese Army was a regular uniform trained army. They both attacked along the south. After Tet, after January of 1968, the Viet Cong were so decimated they ceased to be a force. They were wiped out. And the North Vietnamese Army took 6 months or about 3 months before they could rally again. And you say, well, then why didn't we win? Because at that point, we should have gone north and invaded, and we didn't. But that was their best shot, and they lost. We took it, and they lost. And so I've always believed this. I have always believed that if I can take the best punch you got, everything else is going to be easy. Let me tell you how I got the King James Bible. I got saved, Catholic, no Bible in our home, and I'm riding with this Christian. And I said, well, now that I'm saved, I'm going to have to get a Bible. And do you ever have one of those statements that you didn't know could exist? And here's what I heard. What kind of Bible are you going to get? I said, well, I'm going to get a Holy Bible. I mean, I didn't know. I said, what do you mean, what kind of Bible? And they said, oh, there's all different kinds of Bibles. They said, there's an American Standard Bible, there's a Moffat's Bible, there's a King James Bible, it's the hardest, there's a Phillips Bible, there's a Living Bible. I went through about a half a dozen Bibles. That was the first time I heard the name King James, and I said, I'm going to get a King James Bible. They said, why are you going to get that one? I said, well, if that's the hardest, if I get that one down, all the rest will be easy. And that has always been my thinking. If I can take the best shot you got, you know, really, if somebody really hit you and rocked you and you still stood and you knew that was the best they had, wouldn't you now be encouraged to know that no matter what they hit me with now won't be as bad as that? So I can make it from here. So what I'm going to show you, we're going to look at right now, is the best shot that the anti-King James people have. This shot is so devastating that many real King James Bible believers, not even TR guys, real King James Bible believers will evade it or they fall for it. They can't take it. And we're going to take the best shot because after this, everything will be easy. I want you to go to Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12. And here's what I'm going to do for you guys. You know, I told you I like to be refuted only because it's fun and it's interesting and it motivates me to get a little bit new material. The material I'm going to give you right now is found in the answer book. It's found in Understandable History. You'll get more today than you will in those because those publications were 1987 Understandable History, 1989 answer book. And since then, I've been refuted, so I have more material now. But this is the shot. And let me show you what it is. Acts chapter 12, verse 1. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. And he killed James, the brother of John, with a sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Now, beloved, are you ready when I say that? Okay. Now, beloved, you know I love our dear King James Bible. But unfortunately, this is, again, one of those problems, and it's caused so much trouble over the centuries. For you see that word Easter? That is the Greek word Pascha, or Pascha. And that Greek word appears 29 times in the New Testament. 28 of those times, it is translated Passover. Only once is it translated anything different. And that is here in Acts chapter 12, verse 4. So you see, beloved, Easter is a mistake. It's a bad translation. And so We just have to change that to Passover. Scratch out Easter and put in Passover. Okay, I'm done being a fundamentalist. Because it's painful to do that. It really is. But that is what they do. Now, again, guys, if I said, we're done, go home, somebody here would go, well, what do you know? I mean, he even showed it. It's been there 29 times, and 28 times is Passover. One time's Easter. The weight of evidence is in favor of Passover. I'm worried about my King James Bible. Well, here's what happened. The master's thesis was the understandable history. The doctorate in 1980 was the Acts commentary. And I used to teach, and here's what I don't believe in. When you teach when you're teaching here or teaching in a classroom, teaching here or teaching in a Bible commentary, did you ever, you're looking for a tough passage and you get a Bible commentary and you come down, it's like verse 5, and you come down to verse 3 and verse 4 and verse 6 and verse 7, and the guy's making all these comments, go, whoa, what happened to verse 5? I really did that. I know what this guy believes, and he's teaching, and there's a verse 12 does not teach what he wants to teach. So I thought, it's going to be interesting to see what he does when he gets to verse 12. And he came down, he explained verse 9, he explained verse 10, he explained verse 11, he explained verse 13, he explained verse 14. That is exactly what he did. He stepped over it like it wasn't, he just ignored it like it wasn't even in the Bible. And when you teach, if you've ever taken a test and you don't have an answer, you're taking a test and you don't have the answer. And if you leave it blank, it's so glaring. So there's what there's called snowballing. And snowballing means you just write a lot. And you figure they'll just see you wrote a lot. If you say, name three of the 12 disciples or apostles, and the answers start out with 47 years ago, our forefathers brought forth this continent, a new nation dedicated to the proposition, all men are created equal. You realize somebody doesn't know the answer. And I would have like 75 students in my class, 25 questions per quiz, per test. And they're thinking this, who on earth is going to look at 20? Nobody's going to look at 25 questions on 75 tests. Yes, he is. And can, be nice to your teacher. If you don't know the answer, leave it blank. It's easier to score that way because I'd read every answer. And when I get those snowballs, I would check it wrong, and in red, because that was the most painful, I would put, don't snowball. Now, with that in mind, I start writing this commentary in the book of Acts, and I got this much down. When I'm writing Acts chapter 1, I know there's a chapter 12. And when I get to chapter 12, I know there's a verse 4. And I know this. And here's what I told God. I wanted the degree, but I said, God, when I get that, I don't have the answer for Acts chapter 12, verse 4. I do not have the answer. But I know there is an answer. And I said, I don't need an answer. I need the answer. Because I said, when I get Acts chapter 12, verse 4, I am not going to skip over it. And I am not going to snowball. And if I don't have the answer when I get to Acts chapter 12, verse 4, I am going to stop. We're not getting degree. And we're just going to stop the process right here because, guys, what are you doing writing a Bible commentary if you can't answer the hard questions? So while I was doing that, now I'm in chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, and I'm working up toward 12, I began a study. And the study was a common one. Guys, the Bible is our final authority in all matters of faith and practice. But I told you, sometimes we go to concordance. Sometimes you go to the Webster's Dictionary. Sometimes you go to maybe Haley's Bible Handbook or Hyslop's Two Babylons. And I went to Hyslop's Two Babylons, and I began a study on Easter. And here's what I found out. Easter was a pagan holiday. I have not looked at either a current dictionary or encyclopedia, but up to even 10, 15 years ago, you could get a dictionary, like a Webster's, and look at Easter. And the first thing that it'd say, this is a pagan holiday. In the average encyclopedia, it would say, this is a former pagan holiday. So Easter, historically, is a pagan holiday. And it had a female deity. And her name was Astarte or Ishtar, which is pronounced Easter. It is associated with the vernal equinox. We just passed it up not quite a month ago. You guys know that June 21st is the longest day of the year. That is, we have more daylight the day before it's shorter, the day after it's shorter. June 21st is the longest day of the year. December 21st is the shortest day of the year. It's the most darkness. So if you have the longest day and the shortest day, then twice in the year you have to have what? An equinox, when day and night are equal. That's what equinox means. Between June and December, you have the fall or the autumnal equinox. Between December and June, you have the vernal equinox. And here's how they date Easter, how they establish the date for Easter. They say it is the first Sunday after the first full moon after the vernal equinox, to which I always add, yeah, just like it says in the Bible. For that reason, the date of Easter can always change. This year, Easter was April 20th, 2015. Notice my iPad here. Somebody said, how come I don't use an iPad? I said, because the batteries never go dead on this and I can use it below 10,000 feet. This year, April 20th is Easter. Next year, April 5th is Easter. It can actually, because it is dated by the, it's a fluid date, it can be anywhere between March 22nd and April 25th. I think last year, if I'm not mistaken, I think last year Easter was in March. It is a celebration of regeneration. Am I right? Was this one of the toughest winters you guys ever had here? You say, how'd you know? It was like that everywhere. Global warming devastated everybody. We had 10 inches of global warming. I had to get on. I'd spent 5 hours in May on the roof of my motorhome shoveling 5 inches of global warming off of it. And every place I go, they said, oh man, this was the toughest winter we had. And after you've had a tough winter, you know what's beautiful? Those little spring green buds. And finally it warms up. I mean, you kind of go, oh, isn't it good to have spring come? I bet somebody here, you say, oh, isn't it finally, we finally have some decent weather, okay? Well, that's what it was. After a tough winter, the earth was regenerating itself. And so this was a celebration of regeneration. Now, because regeneration was the subject, the symbols were an egg and a rabbit. Both of these are known for their regeneration. I mean, did not Hugh Hefner figure out the rabbit part? Okay? And everybody understands that the egg and the rabbit, in fact, let me give you a little challenge. I don't always say challenge, but here's the challenge. What is it about an egg? Think of an egg. Think of a rabbit. What is it when you look at an egg or a rabbit and go, that makes me think of the resurrection? Taking a hot dog out of a shoebox is more a symbol of the resurrection. Isn't that right? I mean, really, what? I mean, unless when the Lord stepped out of the tomb, he scared off a bunny rabbit and stepped